Random House Audio presents The Mephisto Club by Tess Gerritsen, read for you by Carolyn McCormick. They looked like the perfect family. This was what the boy thought as he stood beside his father's open grave, as he listened to the hired minister read platitudes from the Bible. Only a small group had gathered on that warm June day to mourn the passing of Montague Saul, no more than a dozen people, many of whom the boy had just met. For the past 6 months, he had been away at boarding school, and today he was seeing some of these people for the very first time. Most of them didn't interest him in the least. But his uncle's family, they interested him very much. Dr. Peter Saul looked like his dead brother Montague, slender and cerebral in owlish glasses, brown hair thinning toward inevitable baldness. His wife, Amy, had a round, sweet face. Their son, Teddy, was 10 years old, all skinny arms and legs. Finally, there was the daughter, Lily, 16 years old. They look so normal, so average, the boy thought, so different from me. Then Lily's gaze suddenly met his, and he felt a tremor of surprise. In that instant, he could almost feel her gaze penetrating the darkest fissures of his brain, examining all the secret places that no one else had ever seen. Disquieted, he looked away. At last, the service ended, and the gathering moved toward the boy to tell him how sorry they were that he'd lost his father. "At least you have family here to help you," said the minister. "Family? Yes, I suppose these people are my family," the boy thought, as little Teddy shyly approached. "You're going to be my brother now," said Teddy. "Mom has your room all ready for you." "But I'm staying here, in my father's house." Bewildered, Teddy looked at his mother. "Isn't he coming home with us?" Amy Saul said, "You really can't live all by yourself, dear. You're only 15.
"I won't be alone. My mother will come for me."
There was a long silence. Amy and Peter looked at each other, and the boy could guess what they were thinking.
"She is coming for me," he insisted.
Uncle Peter said gently, "We'll talk about it later, son." In the night, the boy laid awake in his bed, in his father's townhouse, listening to the voices of his aunt and uncle murmuring downstairs in the study. "He's still just a boy, Peter. He needs a family."
"We can't exactly drag him back to purity if he doesn't want to come with us."
"When you're only 15, you have no choice in the matter. Adults have to make the decisions." The boy rose from bed and slipped out of his room. He crept halfway down the stairs to listen in to the conversation. "And really, how many adults has he known? Your brother didn't exactly qualify. He was so wrapped up in his old mummy linens, he probably never noticed there was a child underfoot."
"That's not fair, Amy. My brother was a good man."
"Good, but clueless. I can't imagine what kind of woman would dream of having a child with him. And then she leaves the boy behind for Monty to raise? I don't understand any woman who'd do that." The boy heard the floor creak above him, and he glanced toward the top of the stairs. He was startled to see his cousin Lily staring down at him over the banister.
"Oh," said Aunt Amy, "you're up."
His aunt and uncle had just come out of the study, and they were standing at the bottom of the stairs looking up at him.
"Are you feeling all right, dear?" said Amy.
"Yes, Auntie."
"It's so late. Maybe you should go back to bed now?"
But he didn't move. He said,
"Aunt Amy, I've made up my mind."
"About what?"
"About my summer and where I'd like to spend it."
She instantly assumed the worst.
"Please don't be too hasty. We have a really nice house right on the lake."
"But I've decided to come stay with you."
His aunt paused, temporarily stunned. Then her face lit up in a smile, and she hurried up the steps to give him a hug. Then a grinning Uncle Peter gave him an affectionate clap on the shoulder.
"You're part of our family now," said Amy. As they walked up the stairs together, she was already telling him her plans for the summer. She sounded happy, even giddy, like a mother with her brand new baby. Amy Saul had no idea what they were about to bring home with them. 12 years later. Dr. Maura Isles paused outside the doors of Our Lady of Divine Light, uncertain whether she should enter. The parishioners had already filed in, and she stood alone as snow whispered down onto her uncovered head. If she was going to join them, this was the time to step inside. She hesitated because she did not truly belong among the believers inside that church. But the music called to her, as did the promise of warmth and the solace of familiar rituals. Out here on the dark street, she stood alone, alone on Christmas Eve. She walked up the steps into the building. Even at this late hour, the pews were filled with families and sleepy children who'd been roused from their beds for midnight mass. As the strains of Adeste Fidelis faded, Maura slipped into the first empty seat she could find near the back. Almost immediately, she had to rise to her feet again to stand with the rest of the congregation as the entrance song began. Father Daniel Brophy approached the altar and made the sign of the cross. "The grace and peace of God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you," he said. "And also with you," Maura murmured along with the congregation. Although Daniel was unaware of her presence, Maura was focused only on him, on the dark hair, the graceful gestures, the rich baritone voice. Tonight she could watch him without shame. Tonight it was safe to stare. Daniel began to read. "And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people, and this shall be a sign unto you. Ye shall find the babe wrapped in..." He paused, his gaze suddenly catching on Maura. He cleared his throat, looked down at his notes, and continued reading. Although he now knew she was seated among his flock, his gaze did not again meet hers. Not during the singing of Cantate Domino and Dies Sanctificatus, not during the offertory or the liturgy of the Eucharist. As others around her rose to their feet and filed forward to receive communion, Maura remained in her seat. If you did not believe, it was hypocrisy to partake of the host, to sip the wine. Yet she remained through the concluding rites, through the blessing and the dismissal. The mass now ended, people began to file out of the church. Maura was just stepping into the aisle when she glimpsed Daniel trying to catch her attention, imploring her, silently, not to leave. She sat back down, conscious of the curious gazes of people as they filed past her pew. She did not return their looks. As the church emptied, she stared straight ahead, stoically focused on the altar. "Hello, Maura." She looked up and met Daniel's gaze. The church was not yet empty, yet at that moment Daniel's attention was so centered on Maura, she might be the only other person in the room. He slid onto the bench beside her. "I'm surprised to see you here."
"It's Christmas Eve, after all."
"But you don't believe."
"I wanted to hear some music, be around other people."
"Don't tell me you're all alone tonight." She gave a shrug, a laugh.
"You know me, Daniel. I'm not exactly a party animal."
"I just thought, I mean, I assumed."
"What?"
"That you'd be with someone, especially tonight."
They both fell silent as the organist came walking up the aisle, carrying her tote bag of music. "Good night, Father Brophy."
"Good night, Mrs. Easton. Thank you for the lovely performance."
"It was a pleasure."
The organist continued toward the exit. They heard the door swing shut, and they were finally alone.
"So why has it been so long?" he asked.
"Well, you know the death business, it never lets up."
"So, how have you been?" she asked.
"You know about Father Roy's stroke last month? I've stepped in as police chaplain."
"Detective Rizzoli told me."
"I was at that Dorchester crime scene a few weeks ago. I saw you there."
"I didn't see you. You should have said hello."
"Well, you were busy," he smiled.
You can look so fierce, Maura. Did you know that?
She gave a laugh.
Maybe that's my problem. Problem?
I scare men away.
You haven't scared me.
How could I? She thought. Your heart isn't available for breaking. Deliberately, she glanced at her watch and rose to her feet. It's so late, and I've already taken up too much of your time. It's not as if I have.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.